Good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure to welcome you to this event, At Any Price Negotiating Access to Crisis. I'm Dr. Dean Marchbein. I'm an anesthesiologist and work with Doctors Without Borders, and I'm also Vice President of the U.S. Board of Directors of Doctors Without Borders. Tonight you may hear Doctors Without Borders referred to as MSF, which is the acronym for our French name, Médecins Sans Frontières. Tonight we have a packed house, I'm happy to see, so I'd ask you to please allow people access to the center seats, and I'd also ask you to take a moment to silence your cell phones. We're pleased to welcome our distinguished guests for tonight's discussions about the dilemmas faced by humanitarian groups and human rights organizations as they try to reach people in crisis. What are the similarities and the differences between the two approaches? How are decisions made about when to speak out? And what sorts of compromises are made, and to what end? We have printed bios of all of the speakers, but briefly, I'd like to introduce them. Joining us as moderator tonight is David Rode, foreign affairs columnist for Reuters and The Atlantic Monthly. Our panelists include Kenneth Roth, Executive Director of Human Rights Watch, Sophie Delaney, the Executive Director of Doctors Without Borders USA, Fabrice Weissman, Research Director for MSF's Reflection Center in Paris called The Crash, and last but certainly not least, Professor Dirk Solomons, Director of the Program of Humanitarian Affairs at Columbia University's School of International Public Affairs. So I want to thank you all for coming and to join us in hearing this interesting conversation. So without further ado, I'll turn this over to David.
Thank you so much. Thank you very much. Can you hear me?
No.
I can shout. Oh, there we go. Magic. Thank you all for coming. It's thrilling to see such a large crowd tonight. I'm honored and lucky to moderate this panel. The way we're going to run the evening is first, each speaker is going to talk for about 5 minutes about the basic theme we're talking about tonight. Then I'm going to try to moderate a conversation among the panelists for about 30 minutes or so. At roughly 8 p.m. Or maybe earlier, we'll start taking questions from the audience. And we'll wrap up at 8:30 after 90 minutes altogether. I do want to do one thing at the outset, which is applaud MSF for this book. If there's anyone here who has worked in the humanitarian field or human rights field, it's an extraordinary compendium of the history of humanitarian interventions and also the tremendous dilemmas. And even if you're funding and supporting these groups, the tremendous dilemmas that people face in the field, and I think how sophisticated governments and different warring factions have become in dealing with Westerners when they arrive in their countries. And with that, I'll now turn it over to Sophie first to give her initial thoughts.
Thanks, David. Can you hear me well?
Yes.
Okay. So I will start by actually providing you a perspective of how this book was, where it came from, and why we MSF decided to look at this issue of humanitarian negotiations. Actually, this book results from a reflection that started a couple of years ago, following a series of incidents inside MSF and some trends that we observed outside in the aid world. And around these incidents and phenomenon, discussion around the humanitarian space started. It has always existed, but the way it has developed recently was triggered by this incident. Externally, it was a time when we reported an increasing number of security incidents against aid workers, with more and more aid workers being the victim of targeted attacks on the ground. And internally in MSF, this period 2 years ago coincided also with the expulsion of our teams for Niger and later on, we were forced to, the two sections of Doctors Without Borders, the French section and a Dutch one, were forced to close their program in Darfur following the indictment of President Bashir by the International Criminal Court. So these were very important incidents for us that actually led to a certain internal paranoia inside the organization. And this paranoia led us to decide in some circumstances to keep a very low profile and not to communicate publicly in face of some important abuses of violence. And you will, if you read the book, you will see that both in Yemen and Sri Lanka, for example, these were circumstances where we decided that we had more to lose by communicating than staying silent, given the medical impact we had on the population. So at that time, there was a sentiment that was developing externally, but also inside MSF, that the humanitarian space was shrinking. But when you look at the state of affairs in the aid system, there are many indications that contradict this sentiment. Is the space shrinking when there has never been so many resources allocated to aid? Is the space shrinking when, in fact, there's never been so many organizations working, so many people on the ground providing assistance? MSF is no exception to this. We started as a very micro organization 40 years ago, and we are now a $1 billion movement delivering assistance in 65 countries. As we speak, we have 27,000 people on the ground. So the idea that our space is shrinking is a little bit contradictory with the real situation. And not to mention the fact that when you look at the history of humanitarian action, you realize that obstacles to access have always existed. It has always been difficult to access areas in Ethiopia. It has always been difficult to operate in Sudan. There are countries where we've never been able to reach certain areas. In the North Amkyong in North Korea, we've never been allowed to develop programs, for example. So then, following these discussions internally, the authors of the book decided to conduct a critical review of some of the recent experiences of MSF in delivering assistance, and to try to figure out what was the space available, what was the humanitarian space, and how do we, as MSF, manage to gain this space or to protect it. And what they found was actually that in all these examples, in all this historical review, there is never a predetermined space for intervention. In every single circumstances, MSF has to negotiate the space. And the space you gain in these circumstances, of course, depends on the relevance of your intervention, but it also depends very much on the interest of the parties. If the parties have interest in having you in this country, then you are more likely to increase your space of intervention. And what is interesting in their findings also is that this negotiation always forces you to compromise. What's left in your independence is that you always have the ability to decide whether or not this compromise is worth it, whether it's satisfactory, and whether you think that it is outweighed by the medical benefit of your impact. So just to finish this short introduction, what I personally find compelling in this book is that it helps us rethink and redefine our own understanding of the humanitarian principles and the way we constantly claim it. Because if we acknowledge that there are humanitarian rules in our work, that there are rules around the intent of providing humanitarian assistance and in the how to provide humanitarian assistance, it is clear through this demonstration that there is no tangible right for a humanitarian space, and that you will never gain this space by claiming a sort of pure humanitarian action, by claiming that you are the one to be impartial, independent, and neutral. You will gain and conquer the space by negotiating and by defending your conviction, and then by demonstrating your real impartiality through your medical action.
Thank you. Ken?
Okay, well, let me just begin by commending MSF for not only for hosting this evening, but for this very, you know, candid, self-reflective book. I mean, I think it's quite rare for an organization to be so open about the practical dilemmas that it faces, and it's typical of MSF to do this, and to debate it all in public. So I just want to applaud them for doing that, because it's not many groups that would. I've been asked to talk about, you know, is there a difference between a medical or humanitarian group like MSF and the issues that a human rights group like Human Rights Watch would face? And frankly, there are big differences. And so I thought I would just sort of set some of them on the table, and then we'll have time to discuss them. You know, first, the similarities. I mean, we both are very much pushing in similar directions, and I think share some key underlying principles that govern our work. We both, you know, very much believe in the dignity of the individual, this belief in humanity as being at the core of our work. And we, I think, both really try to keep that in mind in all the judgments that we make. We, I think, have both decided that the best way to serve that principle of humanity is through strict neutrality. You know, we do not take sides in conflicts. We do not take sides in political disputes. We are focused, in the case of MSF, you know, only on delivering medical assistance. In the case of Human Rights Watch, only on reporting and defending human rights issues, human rights. And we don't get into sort of a range of extraneous issues that would compromise that basic neutrality. We also both, I think, put a big premium on our independence from governments in particular, but really from anyone else. Human Rights Watch, in our case, we don't take any government money at all. I think both organizations really pride themselves from the distance from governments, that, you know, we walk in as very separate actors. And we may have to negotiate with governments, but we are not governments, and we make sure that we are never seen as the equivalent of governments. I think each organization is also very pragmatic. We don't come in with a particular ideology about how we operate, but we would try to do what works, and what works with the ultimate goal of serving humanity, of serving, you know, our basic human goals. I should also add that we work together a lot. You know, we don't really publicize that, but there is a lot of just very practical cooperation on the ground. And you know, MSF will have facilities there. You know, our researchers will come in, but we very much benefit from the perspective and sometimes just the logistics of MSF's presence in a difficult country. Now, the two organizations or types of organizations face very different practical problems. And the difference stems from the fact that MSF, or, you know, a humanitarian group, a relief group, a development group, what have you, needs not only a physical presence, but a visible physical presence. You know, what good is a hospital if nobody knows it's there? You know, so you have to sort of establish facilities on the ground. And it's known, you have a flag, you know, the government knows that it's there. And that raises all kinds of problems of vulnerability. You've got to worry about protecting your staff, you've got to worry about protecting the people you serve, and you need the government's permission to be there because you're so visibly there that they can kick you out. There's no sneaking in. Human Rights Watch has a much lighter presence. We basically, you know, need one researcher per country. You know, we'd like to put in more, but if we can live with one person there. Our task is to get the information out, and as we collect the information, we can do that very quietly. We don't need a physical presence. We don't need anybody to know that we're there. We often operate clandestinely. And so we don't need government permission. We like to have government permission because, frankly, we like to engage in a dialogue with government that tends to work better. But if the government doesn't want us there, we'll sneak in anyway. You know, and so, no, I mean, seriously, you know, and And so it is, you know, as a result, a lot of these dilemmas that an operational organization like MSF faces, we don't face, because we just sneak them in. Now that means, you know, what we obviously are still concerned about the safety of our researchers. That's a big preoccupation. But the steps that we take don't involve negotiating with governments. They involve issues about, you know, timing and communication and consultation and the like, but not negotiation. Now, there are times when, you know, a country is closed and we will risk sneaking in. There are other times, say in North Korea, where it is so dangerous even to sneak in that we will operate on borders. But you can still get a lot of information by talking to people who come and go, you know, refugees and the like. And we don't, in a sense, have to physically be at the site of an abuse. We can simply talk to somebody who was there. And again, that distance makes it a little bit easier for us to operate, quite a bit easier, than a group who wants to service the victim, who needs a proximity that is not required for our kind of work. The place where I think we have to do the most negotiation is in a facility where there just is no sneaking in, like a prison. And there, because we are interested in getting into prisons, we do have to talk to governments. And there you know, are certain principles that we will adhere to. You know, we will not speak to prisoners if the government is listening, because we cannot guarantee their safety after we leave. And we will only really go into a prison and talk to prisoners if we can talk to a lot of prisoners, because there's safety in number that way. But if you go in just to talk to one prisoner, we will not report that, because that prisoner is very vulnerable. But that, you know, so we push for as much as we can, but there's usually value, even if you have to go in on a show tour. I mean, I remember going into a Saudi prison once, and, you know, the first thing that I saw when I got in were these brand new carpets that had been laid on the floor, literally a juice bar with waiters behind it, you know, and 12 completely unused computers on the side, you know. Now, you know, that was useful to see, but, you know, it was, I then said thank you very much, and I disappeared into the cells and came back 3 hours later, you know, and learned a whole lot because I was able to talk to a bunch of people. So, you know, even guided tours can be useful, but, you know, there we have to be aware of the principles that we follow, and the principles are very much guided by the safety of the people with whom we talk, and if we can't guarantee that safety, we will just not collect the information. I think both organizations are concerned not simply with the symptoms, but with the underlying causes of problems. And, I mean, I think MSF was very much, you know, in its formative years, you know, this is kind of a basic guiding principle, is that it did worry about why are people suffering, not just relieving the suffering. And that, I think, is one reason why Human Rights Watch has always found such an affinity with MSF, is because we are, you know, looking at systemic problems. We're not simply taking on individual cases, even though obviously the individual cases are very important. Because a group like MSF, you know, frankly, has to place a premium on its physical presence, it obviously cannot speak out in situations where speaking out will jeopardize that presence. And that's okay. I don't find anything wrong with that. And I think that there has to be a division of labor in situations like that. And the role of Human Rights Watch is to do the speaking out, because we don't have to worry about being expelled. We don't have to worry about maintaining a physical presence. And, you know, if MSF or other groups are comfortable giving us the information, we'll use it. But if not, if they feel that even that is too risky, I think that that's okay. I mean, I think that there are times when you know, the ability to provide the emergency care is paramount for a group like MSF. And I, you know, I accept that there will be times when MSF will not only choose not to speak out itself, but also choose not to participate in a process of speaking out, even if it's done clandestinely. I think that there are dangers. I want to highlight two dangers, and then I'll hand off the microphone. One is when governments very consciously try to use the need of humanitarian groups for access to use that against human rights advocacy. And I have in mind what happened in Darfur, where, you know, once President Bashir was, an arrest warrant was sought for him by the International Criminal Court, he responded by expelling the humanitarian groups. Now, the implication was that the humanitarian groups were responsible for this. They weren't at all. But it was a way of sort of fighting back against the human rights groups, which he had no real ability to fight back. He didn't know where we were. You know, we were operating clandestinely there. And so he kind of went after the visible target. And I think the aim was to set the humanitarian movement against the human rights movement, to say, look at all the trouble you caused by getting Bashir indicted. You know, shouldn't you just, you know, go home? This isn't really that important. You know, we're serving people. Isn't it more important to do that? And I think it's important for us to resist that effort to create tension between us, because, you know, the immediate relieving of suffering, the care of people is important, but it shouldn't be something pursued at the expense of parallel efforts to address underlying causes. And I think we have to kind of keep the symptom and cause issue in view and pursue both, each within our institutional mandate, but make sure that we don't sort of try to silence the one for pursuit of the other. The other tricky thing that comes up is when a humanitarian group or a development group is allowed to operate, but in politicized circumstances where the government doesn't respect principles of neutrality. But it, you know, for example, in Ethiopia, where the government very consciously diverts aid so that it only goes to government supporters. Now, you know, what does a group do there? We've had big problems with the big government development agencies because they're so eager to get the money out the door. They see Ethiopia as sort of a basically a non-corrupt place to spend the money, that they're loath to stop doing that or to create too much trouble. So when Human Rights Watch put out a very detailed report describing this politicization of the aid, the European Union responded not by honestly looking at it, but by commissioning a so-called desk study, where instead of sending somebody back into the field the way we just had and, you know, take testimony and find out what was really going on, they had somebody sit at their computer and look at their procedures and say, this couldn't possibly happen with our procedures, so therefore it didn't happen. You know, and that kind of, you know, conscious dishonesty, you know, kind of putting on the blinders and closing one's eyes to what's really happening, is, that's a problem. I think that we, you know, when these dilemmas arise, where aid can only be delivered in a compromised way, I don't necessarily prescribe stopping the aid, but rather, you know, finding ways to address the politicization or the misuse of the aid by speaking about it, by you know, revealing that it's happening, by pressuring the government to address it. And these are difficult issues because at a certain point, the end result may be that you get expelled altogether. But it is, and you know, there may be something to be said that, you know, you're better off getting some aid in there, even if it's only to government supporters, than not get it in at all. You know, you get more difficult situations where the government is using the aid to actually commit abuses, which is what Ethiopia is doing with its whole forced villagization program. So these, you know, you get more and more complicated as you get further into these issues. But there are areas where, you know, at some point the level of complicity in government abuse becomes too much, and then the answer is to stand back. But obviously one has to be reluctant to do that because pulling back does mean depriving people of benefits that they otherwise would have received. So I'll stop there.
Great, thank you very much. Dirk?
Well, thank you. A fascinating book, it's a pity it's not here yet. Sophie just talked about some of the security problems that aid workers have. And Ken just talked about the politicization of aid, which works two ways. We work with governments who push us in directions we don't want, but we also work for governments who push us into directions we don't want. And I'd like to talk a bit tonight about this whole question of perception. Why is it so difficult currently for aid workers to gain access? Why do they hate us? In fact, you could argue that for the bad guys, the West is the ultimate role model. The ones who are trying to commit genocide have the most wonderful examples from the Second World War, how to do it at industrial strength. If starving civilians is your game, then looking at what Stalin did in Ukraine in the old days is state-of-the-art, hard to beat. Comes to ethnic cleansing, from the way we got rid of the Indians to the Western doings in the Balkans, there's a lot to be learned. And when it comes to killing civilians to depress and demoralize your opponent, Think of the way the V2s are raged over London. Think of the bombing of Dresden. Think of the ultimate massive attacks on civilians in Hiroshima, Nagasaki. So I think it's important for us to realize that we are not wearing a halo, and that the West, if it is a role model, often is so in a negative manner rather than a positive one. So even the vulnerable groups whom we want to help, the people who need us, look at us with a certain amount of suspicion, given our spotty track records. There are still memories of colonialism, exploitation of resources, coups plotted by intelligence services, proselytizing by religious fanatics, and all this makes us somewhat suspect in the eyes of the global South. And it doesn't at all match the way we see ourselves in the West. We're proud of our high ideals, our human rights standards, our democratic systems, the proud achievements of our market economies. And when we step out of our comfort zone to do good, to provide relief, to relieve suffering, we're surprised that people don't see the halo over our heads, the love and the solidarity shining from our eyes, and the wisdom emanating from our superior value systems. So we have to prove our worth against the odds. The struggle for acceptance, something that's a recurrent theme in the book, there are a couple of lessons to be learned from this. If we want to shout out, trust us, we're not all the same. We're not all actors in a devilish Western plot to destroy your culture or steal your resources or defile your faith. If we want people to understand, there's an enormous diversity in Western society. There are people who care, people who don't care, people who want to harm, people who want to heal. Then we have to accept that the same thing holds true on the other side, that our quick generalizations about those hopeless regimes, those corrupt officials, those bloodthirsty primitive natives, those oppressive male-dominated families, their perceptions also distort reality. We should get to the point where every society can be and should be deconstructed to the point where you ask, what is the diversity here? How do viewpoints differ? Who stands for what? Who is constructive and caring? And where can we build bridges? And that requires honesty on our part, large dose of humility, coming clean who we are, what we stand for, what motivates us, willing to listen. And there, MSF has a true advantage. It can step forward and claim that it believes in humanity, impartiality, neutrality, and it can state that it's truly independent, not beholden to any government, international organization, religious group, or commercial sponsor. Apart from MSF, and certainly with an exception for the International Committee of the Red Cross, who else can say that? Who truly upholds those old Dunantist values? Here, the international community has betrayed the genuinely neutral, independent, impartial, and humane activists in the field by stealing those values and claiming the mantle of humanitarians for everyone in the relief industry. This muddles the waters and it confuses those whom we want to help. What's left of our humanity and solidarity when we deliver aid by remote control, asking the locals to take the risk while we run relief operations from the comfort of the hotel in a neighboring country? How can relief operations claim to be neutral when they're conducted under the aegis of a United Nations program, where the Security Council has clearly defined who are the good guys, who are the bad guys, and where the UN peacekeepers, for example, support a venal and predatory army in the Democratic Republic of Congo? How can such operations be neutral when they're conducted by bilateral agencies from countries that have a dog in virtually every fight, from Iraq to Afghanistan to Sudan and the DRC Congo, when they're tasked to win hearts and minds? How can religious aid organizations call themselves impartial humanitarians, when they take decisions on reproductive health based on their beliefs instead of the needs of their clients? What is left of impartiality when politicians decide how much aid goes to which crises? When some UN appeals get 10 cents in a dollar, for example, try to get money for the Burmese refugees in the Thai border, whereas other operations get full dollar, like Darfur, why do we spend hundreds of dollars on each Kosovo refugee in the 90s, and maybe 10 cents for each Congolese refugee? So these issues clearly show that there is no independence in the aid industry. It's very much driven by political forces. And to some extent, the well has been poisoned by the so-called sphere standards. It's a set of norms for service delivery developed after this mismanagement of the Rwanda crisis. And these standards come with a resounding humanitarian charter. The charter picks up the norms of the Red Cross movement as if they were generically applicable across the board, chiefly assuming that all service providers automatically should claim neutrality, impartiality, independence, even when it flies in the face of the evidence. I was surprised then when countries recipient of our largesse are suspicious. MSF people in the field have been rowing upstream for years, seeking to distance themselves from those pretenders, seeking to convince governments, warlords, insurgents, village elders, that they are simply driven by the medical ethos of stepping in where people are vulnerable and have no agenda beyond healing and sometimes speaking up for those who otherwise would not be heard. People in areas where the humanitarian needs are greatest, where the violence is at its worst, where destruction is overwhelming, may be deprived of everything, but they've kept their wits. They know what's what. They follow the media, and they can distinguish between what is genuine and what is driven by ulterior motives, what is compassionate, and what is a ploy for hearts and minds. Later on tonight in discussion, I might cite a press release from Al-Shabaab. And you'd be surprised how sophisticated these people are and how they know what we're doing and what we're thinking. And that's why often MSF, and also the ICRC, which has a legal mandate, that's often why MSF and the ICRC are the only actors whom everyone trusts on all sides of the battlefield. And that's why it's so important to have a discussion like we have tonight. How do we protect this amazing organization from its detractors and its imitators? How can we strengthen MSF's negotiating position by protecting its integrity? Thank you.
Thank you very much. And Fabrice will finish our statements. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Kenneth and Dirt, for these interventions. And I wish MSF would be accepted for the reason you mentioned, Dirk, because of our so-called integrity. But the reality, I think, is more trivial, in a sense that, as Kenneth observed, we deploy our operation always in a politicized environment. And the reason why we are accepted by the Shabaab, for instance, might not only be because we don't support the war on terror, we don't pretend to export democracy, we don't want to convert people to Christianism and so on, but also because we treat their combatants, because we keep quiet, we don't tell the world about the way they oppress the population under their control. We pay indirectly taxes to support their war effort through our staff, which is taxed by the Shabaab. What I mean eventually is that it's unfortunately it's not only the principle which we uphold that allow us to access, but it's also the interest that the varying parties take from our intervention. In that sense, I would say that the instrumentalization of humanitarian assistance is not a scandal per se. It is the condition, the prerequisite for any action. Without manipulation of aid, there is no action on the ground. And this is why we did this book, which is a reflection on what is an acceptable compromise between our interest and the interest of either the government of Sudan, the UN permanent member of the Security Council, or various rebel groups in DRC, in Somalia, or in Afghanistan. So it's a reflection on what is an acceptable compromise. And one of the compromises we make quite often, and I will develop on this aspect, is to remain silent about what we see and to make no comment on the events we might witness. And it has actually, especially for the past 5 to 10 years, I would say, MSF has been very very silent, I would say, and as opposed to the image it has of a very vocal humanitarian organization, not only involved in service delivery, but also willing to be more than a health service provider, but also a humanitarian organization engaged in the public debate. And this conception of speaking out, which basically was not part of the idea of the founder of MSF, which were very, which basically duplicated the way the ICRC was functioning. The founder of MSF were committed to the idea that to access crisis zone, we had to remain silent about what we would see. And the first MSF charter was really insisting on the fact that MSF members would not make any public comments on events or forces that allow them to operate. And it's in the 80s that a new generation of leaders invented somehow witnessing, témoignage, as part of MSF humanitarian mandate. And this is somehow for the reason mentioned by Kenneth, two of the reasons you mentioned. The first one was precisely the idea that without public pressure, sometimes we cannot reach an acceptable compromise. That in some instances, and it was the case in Ethiopia in the mid-80s, the conditions imposed by the government are not acceptable in the sense that they force us to, they co-opt us against the interests of the population. In the mid-80s in Ethiopia, there was this big famine resulting from a structures policy carried out by the government, and food food relief centers were used as a trap to deport populations in a very little way from the north to the south of the country. And humanitarian organizations were therefore a cog in a little process and were part of a trap and were used against the interest of the population we were supposed to assist. And therefore, in that situation, the use of media campaign, the mobilization of opinion was for MSF a way to try to extract itself from a situation whereby we were more helping the tormentors than the victims. And I fully agree with Kenneth when you say that there are situations in which abstention is preferable to action, and there are situations in which denunciation is a duty for humanitarian organization. And this is part of MSF history. The second reason why we used to speak out, I say we used because it has become more rare these days, is also to because we were not willing to be to fall in the trap of the pity, that is to substitute compassion for justice. We need the support of the public to carry on our jobs, and we need the media and the way we the way we depict the situation in which we work sometimes tend to obscure the political dimension of the crisis. And therefore, there was a will within MSF to use its voice in order to tell the opinion that there was not only a situation in
of people giving aid on people receiving aid in Sudan, in Congo, in Somalia, but there were also oppressors on people being oppressed, and that we were willing to highlight somehow the political roots of the crisis. But our duty was not only to as you mentioned, Dennis, to assist, but also to address the root causes. But our perception of the root causes has evolved over time. In the 80s, the root causes for the suffering of the population for MSF was mainly communism. In the 80s, we were mainly an anti-communist organization. But this has to be replaced in the context of the Cold War. In the 80s, the detente, there was some kind of detente in Europe, but in the Third World, Soviet influence was expanding in Southern Africa, in Afghanistan, and the number of refugees were increasing, and from 3 to 12 million refugees between the 70s and the 80s, 90% of them coming from communist countries, and therefore addressing the root causes of the crisis for MSF meant mobilizing liberal democracies to strengthen, to reinforce their fight against communism. And we were very instrumental, especially in the state, in supporting the Reagan administration in its effort, especially to provide weapons to the Afghan Mujahideen. After the end of the Cold War, the root cause, MSF thought that liberal democracies it has called upon to fight communism still had a role to play after the end of the Cold War. That is, to facilitate its access to victims, but also to fight against human rights abuses, including by military means. And in a sense, we were our expectations were fulfilled when in 1999. NATO decided to bomb and then invade Kosovo in the name of humanitarianism, and our expectations were fulfilled with the creation of the International Criminal Court in 1998 to prosecute war criminals. And we found ourselves nowadays in a situation whereby we are somehow victim of the success of the humanitarian enterprise and its appealing and its adoption by as a general narrative by Western state, but not only Western state, also by every political movement. And I would say one of the reasons why MSF is less keen these days to raise its voices and to mobilize public opinion in order to tackle the root causes of the crisis in Sudan or in other countries, because it has become very skeptical about the benefits we can expect from the this militarization and of the struggle for human rights and this criminalization of this fight for human rights as exemplified by the work of the ICC. And just to launch the discussion, and I would maybe object to Kenneth that in Darfur we were not victim of the strategy of the government, which tried to oppose human rights organization with humanitarian organization. We had a real opposition. We had a real disagreement on the relevance of human rights organization mobilization with regards to the situation in Darfur on support for a military option in Darfur and its support for criminal justice. So I would conclude like this on this issue, on that in certain situation, but what's an acceptable compromise? How would I conclude?
You don't have to conclude yet. We've got
let's start the discussion right now. Sorry for this.
No. It's great. There's been a tremendous evolution in MFS's thinking over the years, and it's because of the tremendous dilemmas it faces. I just want to start out with a very sort of simple question and ask you about Syria. People are dying tonight in the city of Homs. Countless people are being tortured in jails in Syria. And I just wanted to ask, I'll just do Sophie and Kenneth for this one. You know, what do you each see as your sort of organization's responsibilities right now regarding Syria? You know, what are you doing there? And then, you know, what actions are you taking? To start with Sophie, MSF is, I assume, trying to help people, but if you're hearing information about what is happening there, you know, what happens to that information that you get from people you're giving aid to?
Yes, Syria is interesting in the sense that we are sitting next to each other tonight, and it's certainly one of the few crises where Human Rights Watch and Médecins Sans Frontières are actually speaking almost with a similar voice, or at least where our public speaking is converging. What we witness in Syria in recent months, we've been struggling to enter Syria and to negotiate with the Syrian authorities access to the population in order to be able to assess the needs and to provide medical assistance if needed. What we were able to develop were clandestine operations outside of Syria also. We've obtained authorization to operate and to provide assistance to the Syrian people who needed medical assistance. We also managed to collect testimonies of doctors operating inside Syria. And what we hear is that actually there are lots of needs that are uncovered, mostly among the population that is a victim of violence. And they operate in a very precarious, doctors have to operate in very precarious conditions and to provide assistance to those who are the victim in violence, of violence in hiding. And the doctors themselves are under a lot of scrutiny by the authorities when doing so. So what we witness is a complete disregard and disrespect of the sanctity of health structures in Syria, based on our testimonies, and obviously needs being uncovered. It's for us an acceptable situation. And Fabrice is right to say that we have spoken now less in recent years, and we have less expressed our outrage, and that's why we were, I think, numerous in the organization to applaud the recent public communication that MSF had on Syria, and that echoes Human Rights Watch.
Well, I mean, our strategy has been twofold. You know, one is getting information out, and the second is generating pressure on Assad and his entourage to stop the killing. You know, with respect to getting the information out, I mean, just today we did something on the latest, you know, onslaught on Homs, with publishing a bunch of eyewitness testimonies to the indiscriminate shelling of Homs. You know, give another example there. I guess it was a couple months ago, Assad gave this, you know, sort of softball interview with Barbara Walters, where he said, you know, of course we don't order anybody to kill demonstrators. You know, it's all terrorists doing that. And so we interviewed 60 military defectors about their shoot-to-kill orders that they had received, you know, naming the names of the commanders who had given them. And so we kind of are putting out information to keep in the public eye the level of atrocity that is being committed in Syria. But then, you know, the key is, what do you do about that? And we are, you know, on the one hand, you know, working with Western countries insofar as they're capable, not for the military solution, which actually nobody's advocating, but to put pressure in terms of an oil embargo, targeted financial sanctions, you know, trying to get the International Criminal Court involved. And we've been quite successful there. I mean, just the defectors report that we did named 22 commanders 21 of them were, you know, within a week on the EU list of sanctions. So they, you know, kind of very directly took that information and applied it. But a lot of our effort recently has been around the Security Council with the aim, because the Security Council has the capacity to impose, you know, mandatory sanctions, particularly an arms embargo, that would have to be universally adhered to. And the difficulty there has been trying to isolate Russia and China, which had been hiding behind Brazil, South Africa, and India. So we put a lot of effort into, you know, working with the press in India, South Africa, and Brazil to highlight their abstention on the last round of Security Council action, which made it easy for Russia and China to veto. Brazil is now off the council. Pakistan has replaced it. But they all, this time around, voted for the resolution. China and Russia still vetoed, you know, despite huge efforts. We've had two press conferences in Moscow. We've been, you know, doing everything we can to kind of raise the temperature there. We'll keep going. But I think at this stage, the Security Council has kind of made itself irrelevant. And so we're looking at other fora, whether it's the General Assembly or other places where we can kind of keep stressing to Assad and his government that they are isolated, that their days are numbered, and that this strategy of kind of killing their way into staying in power is just not going to work. So that's, you know, it's there's not a simple solution in a difficult situation like this, but that's kind of the longer term aim.
And I'll ask one more and then open it up to questions. I wanted to ask Fabrice and maybe Dirk, a real dilemma for journalists involves war crime tribunals and whether or not journalists should testify at war crimes tribunals based on what they see on the ground. Clearly, there are situations where human rights workers are going to witness evidence of crimes that could be valuable, you know, at war crimes trials. And what is MSF's position on, you know, its staff testifying at such places? And I'm curious also what Ken's position is. And I have a feeling Dirk will question the legitimacy of those trials. But if we can answer briefly, because we've got, you know, it's almost 8, and I really want to open it up to questions.
Okay. So, although MSF supported the creation of the International Criminal Court, we adopted as a general policy not to cooperate with the court for the same reason as the journalist, because of the possible incompatibility between our work on the cooperation with the court. That cooperating with the court would jeopardize our ability to access crisis zone for the very reason that most of the people involved in war